Hey, good morning, grade 12s. It's 6 May. All right, so don't forget, Friday, the 8th of May, we'll be coming by and collecting and delivering more material. Make sure your quiz is done. Today, we'll just finish up Unit D, Precision Measurement. I'll do a little quick, just review of two-step equations. Like, this is a biggie. And we've already been doing some of this anyway, so it's a good idea to just keep practicing solving algebra. So there's the plan. Friday, make sure somebody's home. And if it's not collected, it has to be in no later than 8 May. So you could send a readable screenshot, or if you know how to scan using the notes function on your Apple device or on your Android, you can scan documents. But I want this by 8 May. No later than... Put it in the post office if you have to. Put 30 cents... I guess it's like a dollar worth of stamps. But get it to me no later than 8 May. Because we have to submit that mark to your sponsors. All right, and I'll be sending home a midterm test as well. Okay, so let's just quick review of what we did yesterday, multiplying uncertainties. So yeah, we're talking about accuracies and precision and how close are you to the truth when you measure something. So if I said, what is 5, give or take 1, times 7, give or take 1? Well, you know what? It could be anywhere from, let's see, it could be as high as 6, that'd be 5 plus 1, times 8, which is 7 plus 1, so it could be as high as 48, unless it was really 4 times 7 minus 1, which would be 6, which is 20, that's a big difference. How would you like it if your boss says, oh, I'll give you about $5 a day for the last 7 days or so? So how much money is he going to give you? Is he giving you $24 or is he giving you $48? It'd be kind of nice to have a little more accuracy. And that's what this unit's all about. And here, I'll draw, you know me, I like to draw diagrams. If you're not doodling and sketching and doing stuff like this to convince yourself in the way that you understand, that'd be crazy, all right? So there's something that would be 4 by 6. And here's something that would be 6 by 8, right? If you were doing rectangles, remember how to do areas of rectangles? So yeah, 4 by 6... 4 days at $6 a day is a little bit different than $8 at $6 a day, if you want to think of it in that terms. So yeah, you want to be kind of accurate. You don't want 5 give or take 1, right? Is it 5 take away 1, or is it 5 1 more than 5? So there's the idea. So let's read and do the one about your aunt here. So your aunt decides she wants to make a patio with those paving stones, right? So read and do. Pause. Okay, so you've read it. So the maximum area she could get, well, here's her, what we call the nominal area. She thinks it's 12 by 10. She's not quite sure. She never did learn how to use a tape measure. So it could actually be 14 by 12. Because she's not sure. She was just eyeballing it. Or you know what? It might only be 10 by 8. So look at the difference there, right? 10 by 8 is pretty tiny compared to 14 by 12. And it's all because she was uncertain by give or take 2 feet on each dimension. So quite a big difference there in the number of paving stones, in the size of her patio. She's not sure. So there's a big difference. If your measurements aren't accurate, you want to have accurate measurements. Unless you don't mind, just having a useless kind of patio. So there's that diagram. So there's the little paving stones. Did you see me putting down the paving stones there? Each one of those paving stones is 8 inches by 4 inches. All right, so you'd start laying down your paving stones there. So how many pavers would you need? Well, let's see. How big is one of those paving stones? How big is a paver? Well, they're 8 inches by 4 inches. But you know what? We're doing everything else in feet. So we better do apples with apples and oranges with oranges. So we're going to have to convert those to feet. So I hope you know that there's 12 inches in a foot. And remember how to convert from grade 10. So that's 2/3 of a foot. And for those of you who decline to be eager about fractions, we'll call it 0.66666 feet. And then, of course, the 4-inch width of your brick is really 0.333333 feet, right? Half as much, right? Because it's half the width. Or you could say that it's 1/3 of a foot. Myself, I love fractions. Fractions are actually kind of trivial, and they're more accurate. In any event, you could say that it's 8 inches by 4 inches, which is really 2/3 times 1/3. You could say that it's 2/9 of a square foot. But, of course, I don't think too many people use fractions. It's a shame, though. Or you could just do it in that crazy decimal system and use your calculator and say that it's 0.22222 square feet. So let's stick with that. Let's not confuse people with fractions, even though fractions are much, much more easy to use in any event. So those are the different sizes. So her paving area could be 168 square feet, or it might be 80 square feet. And now we know how big a paver is, so we could calculate how many pavers. Right, so it's either going to take 168 square feet divided by 0.22. So it's going to take 757 pavers to do the big area, if that's how big it is. It might only take 361 pavers to do the little area, but we're not sure. So right away, we're not exactly sure how many to go buy at the hardware store. And then you throw in the money. And you're going, oh my God, you know, I can't tell you how much it's going to cost because you can't tell me accurately how big your patio is going to be. It could be anywhere from $965 to $2,020. All right, so it's pretty hard to tell Auntie how much it's going to cost if she doesn't measure a little bit more accurately how big her patio wants to be. All right. And then we could make it even more complicated because, you know, maybe you don't know how much a paver is. Maybe you just know it's $2 to $3. And that would make it even crazier to try to estimate or calculate how much your auntie's patio is going to cost. If we threw in the fact that we didn't know that exactly, $267, maybe we just said, oh, it's $250, give or take 50 cents. Well, that would make even more difference. Right, so then the patio could cost you $722 if it was only $2, or it might cost you $22.71 if it was actually $3. So you can see that being accurate is kind of important, especially if you're going to spend money. Tolerance, read and do. Okay, so I'm not reading that to you. But there you go. If I send you to the store to get some donuts for the class, and I said, go get $20 worth, give or take two. So that means you could spend either 22 of my money, or you could spend 18 of my money. So I gave you a window. I gave you a spread of numbers, a range that you can spend in. That would be called the tolerance. Now, sometimes a tolerance isn't just give or take the same number. Read this. If you're going to make a door and try to fit a door in an entranceway, you don't want the door to be wider than the entrance. So you might actually say the tolerance on the door is 32 inches. You're allowed to be no inches bigger, but you're allowed to be 1/4 inch or 0.25 inches, even though there's no such thing as a decimal inch. So your door could be 31.75 or 31 3/4 if you do proper inches. All right, so that would be called your target. You're shooting for 32 inches for the door. You're allowed to be none over, but you're allowed to be 1/4 inch under. So there's another way to express the tolerance. Look at this. If you ever get a job manufacturing stuff, if you're going to be doing nice, precise components for fighter airplanes or cars or nice, fine furniture, look at all the tolerances. Look at all the, on this blueprint, look at all the ways they express tolerance. Oh my goodness. You would have to be a machinist to do this stuff, or a very fine woodworker. Here's some practice problems in the notes, and guess what? The worksheets are pretty much the same thing. Read and do. Let's look at dimension B right here, right there. So this is a blueprint of, I don't know, some kind of a component for something. And it says that B is 50 centimeters, give or take 0.5, or 5/10 or 1/2 centimeter. So you could say, well, the target, the nominal size is 50. We're shooting for 50, but it's allowed to be 1/2 centimeter over. So it could be 50.5 upper limit, or it could go down to 49.5 lower limit. So if your job was to make this thing, your boss would accept it if it was between those two measurements. If it wasn't between those two measurements, he'd tell you to go do it over again. So the tolerance, you got a 1 centimeter tolerance there. It can be 1/2 above and 1/2 below. So the difference between the two is 1 centimeter. So there. So that dimension there, the beat, was 50. Give or take, 1/2. How about if we do Charlie here? Uh-oh, look at piece C here. C, is that piece right there? Oh, notice we don't tell you what C is right here, but we do tell you that A is that long, and we do tell you that B is this long. So would you believe that C is going to be the length A subtract the length B? Can you see that? Here's length A going from here all the way to here. And here's length B going all the way from here to here. So this must be length C, which is the difference between A and B. So C is going to be A subtract B. But guess what? A is 74.62, give or take 0.38. And B is 50 plus or minus 0.5. So when you add up all those things, you got the 74.62, take away the 50, which is 24.62. And then you add up all the give or takes. So it'll be give or take 0.38 plus a give or take 0.5, which is a give or take 0.88. So you end up with 24.62, give or take 0.88. So that dimension there along length Charlie is 24.62 centimeters nominal. That's what your target is. And you're allowed to go all the way down to 24.62 minus 0.88. So you're allowed to go, and you're allowed to go all the way up to 24.62 plus 0.88. So you'd be allowed to go all the way up to 25.5 and all the way down to 23.74. And if this measurement wasn't in between those two values, your boss would make you go build it again. So notice how your tolerance there is really just double that number there. How about length D? Length D on this thing that you're building. Right? So it's 19.9, give or take, 0.1 centimeters. Right? 19 9/10 is the proper way to say that, by the way. Give or take 1/10 of a centimeter. So the target is 19.9, and you're allowed to go 0.1 above, and you're allowed to go 0.1 below. So you can go up to 20, or you can go to 19 and 8 tenths. So the tolerance there, there's a difference between the two of 2 tenths, or 0.2 centimeters, which is 2 millimeters. And let's check out echo here. So this little piece here, you're told the target is 12.48 centimeters. You're allowed to be 2/100ths higher, right? You're allowed to be, that's supposed to be 0.02. So you're allowed to be 2/100ths higher, and you're allowed to be 2/100ths lower. So you're allowed to go up to 12.50 and down to 12.46. All right, so it helps if I had put in the right numbers there. This is why you do things nice and neatly and draw pictures and, you know, make sure you're labeling things, because then it's a lot easier if you make a boo-boo to go back and fix it up. But if all you've got is a flurry of numbers all over the place, and it's pretty hard to go back and fix things up. So this is why you show your work. There, so that pretty much wraps it up. So making sure the thing you're manufacturing is built within tolerances is important, especially since accuracy costs money. So if you want a really quality item that's built within nice tight tolerances, you know, like a Mercedes or a BMW, it's going to naturally cost more. Imagine trying to assemble some furniture or maybe your kid's bike if the pieces don't even fit properly. So that wraps up the unit. Do the worksheets. You have 2 worksheets that have answers. And do the unit workbook. So there's a workbook, a bunch of questions from previous exams from the province, and it's got all the answers too. Yeah, let's go. We got a couple more minutes here. So I hope you're still working on your algebra. Oh, yeah. So it's important to kind of take your time doing these things. You know, do a couple, put it aside, do a couple more, put it aside. Don't binge on all this stuff and try to crank it all off in one shot. The beauty of algebra is you do not need an answer key. If you check your answer, if you take it and plug it in other words, evaluate, and it works, then you must have been right. So you can invent your own algebra questions. You don't need me to give them to you. Just make up your own, just like this one. All right, so if I said 3 somethings less 5 is 7. Make sure you do the steps. All right, you probably already guessed at the answer. But don't guess. You're supposed to be doing the steps. So it turns out if you add back the 5, do the same to both sides, and then you're trying to get rid of the 3. So it was multiplied by 3, so you're going to undo the multiply by 3, so you're going to divide by 3. And make sure if you divide by 3 on this side, that you divide by 3 on this side of the equation. And 3 divided by 3 is 1. They magically disappear. And you end up with the A must be 4. And don't forget to check your answer. Evaluate. Plug in. 3 times 4 minus 5. Is that equal to 7? Oh, please, God. Right? Is 12 minus 5 equal to 7? Hey, I think it is. Look at that. That's the answer. You don't even need an answer key. Let's try this one. 7 plus 3 somethings is equal to 28. Well, you probably already guessed this is a 7, right? But don't just do it in your head. Do the proper steps, because they get way more difficult. So you're going to always undo the adding and subtracting first. Reverse bed mass. So we'll undo the adding. So I'm going to undo that 7 that was added to everything. So if I take away 7, hey, that cancels out the adding 7. Make sure I do the same thing on this side. So now I've got 3x's is worth 21. Let's see. 3 times something is 21. I'm going to undo the multiply. I'm going to undo the multiply by 3 by dividing by 3. Because dividing undoes multiplying. And you end up with x is 21 divided by 3 is 7. So use a calculator if you don't have your times tables memorized. That's the beauty of doing algebra like this, too. You can use a calculator to... You don't need to have your times tables perfectly memorized. Although, it'd be crazy if you don't. Make sure to check your answer. Does 7 work? It sure does. So you know you got the right answer. All right, try this last one. Some number, when you divide it by 7, and then take away 3, is 1. All right, so some number, when you divide it by 7, and then take 3 away from that, is 1. So, of course, the first thing you do is... Notice I'm going to skip a couple steps here. I'm going to say I add 3 to both sides. So I skip showing you that I added 3. So that means a divided by 7 is 4. And then I skip showing you that I multiplied by 7. Really, I just kind of popped that 7 up to there. So notice that once you get good at this, if they're real simple like this, if they're simple problems and you can do some of the steps carefully in your head, then you can show every second step instead. But that's only if they're really simple problems. Let me show you a problem that's not so simple. You're going to have to show every step. All right, so I determined that the A was 28. 28 divided by 7 is 4. Correction, 28 divided by 4 is... 28 divided by 7 is 4. Then take away 3 is 1. Hey, we were right. It is 28. So, yeah, you could have probably done those in your head, but I asked you to do the full algebra steps. Here's why. Watch this. What if I said solve this? 49.62 is equal to some number all divided by 8.3 minus 5.44. So this could be a real problem. So it's using real numbers. So you wouldn't be able to skip any steps doing this. You're going to have to do every step. And guessing is definitely out of the question. So I add back the 5.44 that was taken away. You always undo the adding and subtracting first. So that means x divided by 8.3 is 55.06. How do I get rid of this divide by 8.3? The opposite of dividing is multiplying. So I multiply both sides by 8.3. So if I make this side 8.3 times bigger, I better make this side 8.3 times bigger. Otherwise, they wouldn't be equal anymore. And, of course, the reason we picked the 8.33 was because 8.33 divided by 8.33 is 1. And now you get the answer is, the x is 456 and 998 ten thousandths. I guess some people call that 0.998. And let's make sure we check it. So let's take our answer. This was our solution, 456.998. And you plug it in. And I tend to usually plug in using brackets. That way when you go to check it, you know, if you're doing another similar question, usually if your plugins you put in brackets, then it kind of stands out what your plug-in is. You don't have to put brackets, but most teachers put the thing they're plugging in brackets, so they can remember what the heck was I plugging in. You don't have to. So let's plug it in. Let's see if this works when I plug it in for x. And of course, you're going to need a calculator for this. You can't do this one. So when I check it on my calculator, 456.998 all divided by 8.3, then take away 5.4 is 49.62. Woohoo! We got the right answer. So this is why you show the full algebra steps. All right? So you can't go skipping steps unless they're like real, real easy to do in your head. But you still got to do proper algebra. So there, that wraps that up. Have a good morning.